out with this for a minute until I get situated. Okay, do we need more warm water?
I'm fine.
I'm fine too.
You can try yours.
It's like cold.
It's not cold. It's just not as hot as tea usually is.
Oh, so nice.
I love the cups.
They're
this
adorable.
Is like a tea party.
Oh, it is a tea party. Cheers.
And the vibes
cheers.
Here
yes.
are such tea party vibes. Like this boutique area, I live for this.
Cheers, everybody. We're live.
Cheers. Welcome to our tea party.
We got to talk loud, though, because that is really like a mile away. So, welcome back. This is our second show, our podcast. We still don't really have a name. We're just calling it the Aspen Rose Podcast. And I'm the host, Sarah Harvey. And then we've got my esthetician, Rochelle. And then we're interviewing a client and friend of mine, Shamara. And she's actually our first real guest. So we're going to just kind of wing it and see how it goes. The purpose of these podcasts is to show unity and diversity and let everyone have a platform to tell their story, what they've gone through, what they've done to overcome trials. And by watching this, it's my hope that you'll be able to relate with someone and realize that you're not alone in your struggles. And also realize that people that you might think are different than you are probably very similar in areas that you would never know. So we'll jump into it. And we were just discussing how long we've known each other. So do you want to kind of refresh us on how long you've been seeing me?
Yeah, I actually started seeing Sarah in 2019. I was given a certificate to go see her for a massage from a friend of mine. And I was really looking forward to the massage. But while I was getting the massage, Sarah actually started asking me questions that she didn't know any of my backstory. So it was just like, huh? And that just kind of opened up our friendship, and I just continued coming to her because of the energy work and
mm-hmm.
the way she can just read my feelings and what I was going through at that time, and we could discuss it and work through it.
Yeah, so I do energy healing. It's intuitive, so I can just channel people's subconscious mind, and it speaks to me. I'll have memories, visions, and thoughts as if they're my own, but then I will realize that they're not mine, they're my clients. And probably when you came, I just started telling people whatever came up without offering if they wanted it. I can't remember.
I don't really remember either specifically. I just remember that that was how we really got started.
Yeah. So that was 5 years ago, I think. So I was in a small office, and then I moved into my home in a private practice. And then we got here a year ago in July is when we really started, I would say. Yeah, it was about July. I think I got the keys the first week of July. And then if you watched our first podcast, we talked about Rochelle's story a little bit. Do you want to give a refresher?
Well, I've been working here for almost a year. And we kind of just discussed my experience with going to college and having to drop out and
mm-hmm.
start working and my relationship with money and debt and just learning how to flow and be abundant even though you don't know where the money's going to come from and having that life experience. So, I mean, I feel like every time we tell our story, you can go a different way.
Yeah.
But that was a whole thing that we went into. But
yeah,
it's really interesting that you were sharing about how Sarah doesn't know anything about you. And then she'll just totally bring something up and you're like, what? Like, okay, this is like, you're not, well, if you're not used to it, it can be kind of weird. Like it can be kind of like you're creeping me out a little
bit.
And when you did my energy work, I was actually hoping to work here.
Mm-hmm.
And I really wanted to work here. I loved her website. It was just like, I love this. She does energy work. And then I remember when I looked at your website on your job post on Indeed, I like looked you up. And I just really liked that you looked like a real person.
Yeah.
Versus like, I'm an esthetician. So when you're looking for jobs as an esthetician, the owners look like mannequins.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And you just look normal. I was like, oh, this is different. Like she looks like a normal person.
Yeah.
I really wanted to work for you. I come in and I'm like, I made an appointment just so that I can have a conversation with you because you were so busy.
Uh-huh.
I couldn't get an interview. I was like, I'm going to make an appointment with her and I'll just like slip my resume in just to see if I could get a conversation going with her. She does my energy work. She starts talking about like my childhood and I'm like, oh my God, like she's going to think I'm so messed up. Like I'm not going to be able to work here. Like what is happening? But it was really a great atmosphere that you set for like, we're all human.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and I'm picking this up and it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting when people are gifted and they can sense that, you know, you have this issue or whatever, and it, the way that you handle it is,
yeah,
it's really nice because we're always like, we don't really want to talk about this,
mm-hmm.
that stuff in everyday life.
Well, we feel like shame or judged or no one's going to understand us or we're the only ones dealing with it. And I guess I grew up feeling confident enough in myself that I never really cared. And doing this so much with other people. I grew up Southern Baptist with a focus on missions work. And so I've always had a heart for people and just raised, don't judge people. We're all about love and unity. And one of the slogans that I grew up with was each one, reach one. So it's really keeping your mind on other people. And when I started doing all this and reading people's traumas, I don't read it with a mind of judgment. I read it as if I am you. And so I can feel everyone, no one wants to do wrong or, you know, and I've learned so much that we're all suffering and going through it and no one's perfect. And knowing the heart of the person that does something that they might be embarrassed about or feel guilty about, I just think, so before I go into this part, when every session is going to be different and it'll be different based on who we're talking with. So anything we say politically or religiously, use your own terms so that you don't get triggered because I want everyone to feel included. But for me, I know that we all have Christian backgrounds, so the terms will be different with each podcast. But for me, I know that Jesus came without judgment, and he loved, you know, the sinners, and his goal was to help them heal and find the way and to stop living in the life they were living in. And that's exactly verbatim what I do. I have no judgment. You can tell me that you murdered someone last night. I won't have judgment on it. I'll say, let's figure out what got you to this point and how we're going to get you through it and what to do to make up for what you've just done. Because you have to have repentance and you have to give back if you've done wrong. It has to, it's a scale. So that has led me to want to do this. And Sham, you've been with me like forever and we connect, we're on very similar paths. So let's go into your path and we can talk about really anything. What do you feel would be good for people coming on here that they can learn from what you've learned and what your struggles have gone through? Like the hardest stuff you've had to go through.
I think the biggest thing that has really impacted my life was I was diagnosed with bipolar, and we've really been able to work through so many of the issues that I've dealt with therapists for years and years and years and haven't really broken through in all of those areas. And coming here and just having you just bring up something that, you know, was a trigger for me and we can work through it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you've helped me with abandonment issues. You've helped me with, you know, rejection issues, just feeling abandoned and rejected from a childhood.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's really resonated with me. And then just the fact that we can talk about religion,
mm-hmm.
and you can bring that up because that's very important to me and how I view things, and we can have that discussion without it raising any controversy between
yes.
us.
Yeah.
And so, and then just the relationship issues that you've helped with so much, you know, with encouraging me to reach out to my biological father and encouraging me to, you know, to write letters if I couldn't talk to that person directly. And it's just really, it's been a great experience for me. Last year was very difficult. My daughter went on a very long, long vacation and left her two little girls with me. And I almost had to come and see Sarah every week because it was just so difficult in not judging my daughter for her choices and just dealing with the children as they were going through what they were going through. And just, you know, just so much. I had so much brokenness last summer, and she really helped me get through all of that. And to see, and not to judge my daughter, to, you know, to see that she was going through her own thing and that she needed to work through what she was going through in her own kind of way. And that just really helped me a lot last summer. I don't think I would have made it through without you.
Yeah, and when you came in, I was like happy for you because you were telling me that you had to go and take care of these kids. And I was like, that's amazing because it's showing that you're strong.
Yes.
That you're ready for this because you're going to be given more tasks the stronger you get. And with your daughter, yeah, everyone's on their own journey. And so what we're given, we have to just say, what can I do with what I'm given right now and push through? And the part without judging is knowing you've got to let people go to do their own thing. And because it's not about us healing people, it's about us creating a safe space for people to heal themselves, because everyone has their own answer if they can trust themselves and listen. And so with your daughter, allowing her that time to do that, and honoring and respecting her by watching her kids probably is what she needed. And how are things now?
They're much better.
Yeah.
Much, much better.
Good.
You know, there's still growth and healing that needs to be done, but it's been so much better.
Mm-hmm. And looking back, do you see yourself as stronger than you did when you were going into that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Most definitely. Mm-hmm. Just walking through it and looking back and seeing all the hard stuff that we had to face and the fact that I made it through without having a meltdown or a breakdown, and that, you know, I was able to provide the girls with the best care that I could and help them with their emotions and what they were struggling with as being little ones. You know, it's hard for them to really express what they're feeling, but you helped me to tune in a little bit to their emotions and what they were going through, and to look at it, you know, not that they're just being naughty kids, that they were going through
hurting.
Something. Yes.
Yeah. But we were connecting too, because my daughter, I knew what your kids were going through because my daughter had gone through it with her dad not being around, and the way that makes a child react, that a parent can get tired and frustrated, but if you realize their world's getting turned around, and even as adults, we're the same as kids. When our world gets turned around or we're not feeling loved or nurtured, we pout and throw fits or, you know, silent treatment or walk away, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's very similar.
I do want to ask, before you saw Sarah, did you ever have energy work done before? Were you familiar with it at all?
No. I had been in therapy for a lot of years.
That's the interesting part to me, is that you said that you were trying therapy and you just needed like a step further past that, because I feel like therapy is beneficial and helpful and people should do it, but sometimes things are like, you need to be more connected in your body to have that session of feeling it in your body and feeling it release. And like, I know some therapists do that, like somatic.
I think they're starting
holistic.
To
they're starting to
mm-hmm.
It's new,
yeah,
but what you do is like, you name it and you like, you help us feel like we're in tune with ourselves again, you know, and understanding that there is energy going on in and through us and around us makes you feel more like you can make sense of things, you know, like, oh, things are a little bit chaotic.
Mm-hmm.
Did it shut off?
Has it already been 30 minutes?
No.
Unless I changed
it. Cannot
be.
Okay.
Oh, my card's full. All right, so we'll just do it. I'll just save it from TikTok.
Okay, so you can save the whole thing. from TikTok?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, it recorded in full last time.
Awesome.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Great. Yeah, so I'm really interested in how you take it a step further, because a lot of these issues are, you know, something that you would go see a therapist for.
Yeah.
And I feel like, you know, I need therapy a lot of times. But a lot of times therapy, there's like a cost issue. And with coming in here and going to like a holistic spa, you can kind of customize what you need and how often you come in. Like you said, I needed to come in every week. And yeah, I just love that, you know, that physical aspect of it.
Well, therapy is definitely helpful. But like you were saying, it just, there were things that, you know, I would go and talk to the therapist about and we would bring up, but I would come and see Sarah and she would just bring something up that I didn't even realize I was struggling with at that time. I thought, oh, I've already worked through that. But she would bring something up that would bring up different feelings, and we were able to talk about it and work
mm-hmm.
work through it. And I just feel like it's been more released. It's not
mm-hmm.
something that I've just suppressed. I've talked about it with a therapist and now I've just kind of just pushed it down. But we actually were able to release
yeah.
it from my body and from my mind. And it's not something that I struggle with so much
yeah.
anymore. And occasionally something will come up again, but it's like from a different aspect.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, I've noticed with therapy, I think it's good if you need to talk and be heard, but there's only so much of that you can do. And so I feel like there's a point where it has to go into the somatic. I don't know the term you used. What was it you said?
I don't really know, but I've heard people talk
mm-hmm.
about somatic holistic therapy. Therapists
yeah.
are doing this, and it has more to do with your body.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that what you do, it, which is really amazing, is like you said, you bring up stuff that you're not conscious of.
Yeah.
Like you go to a therapist because you kind of get a sense that things are off. You go to a therapist and then it's kind of like they expect you to know what's
yeah,
wrong.
Exactly.
And you're like, I just feel messed up.
Yeah.
I feel like things are not okay. And then they kind of keep asking you questions so that you can kind of say,
mm-hmm.
well, I think it might be this.
Yeah.
But Sarah gets into your
subconscious
body
mm-hmm.
and she feels where it feels chaotic or hollow or blocked. And then she brings up things that are maybe having to do with that, like emotions that are normally stored right there. And then she'll bring it up and you're like, I haven't even thought about this. But now that you mention it, it's like this has been in the back of my mind for
mm-hmm.
years.
Mm-hmm.
And I've experienced that, is like repressed
mm-hmm.
memories. So that I'm 31, so I've been having a lot of like repressed
yeah.
memories come back to
yeah.
me when, and it's really weird.
Yeah, you came in one day and you were like, I'm not well. And I was like, are you 30?
Yeah! Oh my
yeah.
God, I was like, well, I was sick,
yeah.
but I was also like crying.
No, you said that your life was chaotic and you were having all this stuff come up.
Yes.
And I was like, are you 30 yet? And you were like,
how old are you?
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm 30. And then I, like, after that, I turned 31.
Yeah, because right when you hit 30, it's like the soul's done, and that's when you start going back to fix the foundation that was crumbled and the missing bricks from when you grew up, because your world was defined by your childhood. Your brain's done developing at 25, but something in the soul at 30 says, okay, we're done, time to fix it. And so that's when you start falling apart and breaking down and hurting.
Exactly.
Yeah. But I've seen it every time once you hit that 30-year mark.
Yeah, I think like 29 to 30,
mm-hmm.
I was really just, things were just unraveling.
Mm-hmm.
Like things that you build that give you your identity,
yeah.
that you hold on to, that give you comfort. They were all unraveling. And you don't know how to make sense of it. You just keep going.
Yeah.
You just keep going and showing up to your life. Like
mm-hmm.
you just keep showing up to the sink and doing your dishes and you don't know why, like, you're having pain in your knees or
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, becoming more conscious. It's like you're becoming conscious of your unconscious self.
Yeah.
In a way.
Do you have any, because I know you've got a lot of past stories. Is there anything from like before last year that you think would be educational that you've learned? Or anything that the traumas that you've gone through that you've been able to see it differently just over the years where you can kind of share that experience?
I think it would be with my biological father. And just it, he just wasn't a part of my life. And I had a relationship with his parents and his siblings, but I just couldn't bring myself to forgive him or to even allow him to be a part of my life. Mm-hmm. And I really have always struggled with that, the abandonment issue, and felt like I was rejected. Throughout the years of going to visit his family, there would be occasions when he would show up or be at something, and it was like he would just like not even address me. It was like he didn't even act like I was there.
Mm-hmm.
And so that really made me feel rejected, like he didn't want me. But after I finally got to the point where Sarah finally got me to the place where I could give him a call, I did that. We were able to talk a little bit, and I found out that he just didn't even know how to address me or how to even reach out to me after all the years that he wasn't there in my life. And so that has been huge for me, to be able to just release those feelings from my childhood of abandonment and rejection, and just to get to a point where I could forgive him and I can move on with it. We still don't have like the greatest relationship. We don't call each other, but if he does call and I see his name shows up on the caller ID, it's not like, oh my gosh, and you know, I don't get all flustered and all, you know, do I want to answer it? Don't I want to answer it? You know, I can answer it with certainty that I've forgiven him and I can hear what he has to say or what he's what he's calling about, which normally is just some information he wants to give me.
Oh yeah.
So,
that might be an excuse sometimes,
so,
just a call.
Yeah. Definitely. So that has been so huge for me, just getting past that point.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, when my best friend got really sick, she had cancer, and I really struggled with that. We had been friends since we were 10 years old. And so that was really hard for me. But Sarah helped me work through the fact that she was sick and just what she was going through and how I was going to process her sickness and her death if it came to that, which it did. And that was very hard for me. I had a difficult time just accepting that she wasn't healed, which is what I had been praying for and believing for. And just Sarah just helping me see that she had run her race. She had completed her journey. And so that helped me as well, just being able to work through that. Because I think that you were able to bring up things and ask me questions that I hadn't really thought about, or things that I wasn't even, you know, trying to process. You were able to bring up those questions and just help me to work through all of that and to be okay.
Yeah, I've learned when people come and go in our lives, they come in when we need them for reasons. And you guys needed each other your whole life until you didn't anymore. And a lot of people lose their faith because they prayed and held on to a promise that didn't happen. But everyone has their own path, and some finish their path earlier, and some choose to not want to get better because it's hard. Life is really hard. And I had a friend pass recently because this person wanted to move on. She was done. And so it's important that we understand there's so much more happening that we don't know. And we have to surrender to everything, to just let things come and go, as well as people. And what that was telling me, because it was in the same time where I knew you were just so much stronger, and you weren't needing your husband to be home as much, and you weren't you just weren't having as many panic episodes.
Yes.
And to me, having your friend kind of leave was showing me you don't need her anymore, and she can serve you maybe even more on the other side.
Yeah.
So yeah, life is always teaching us so much more. There's a saying, the more I learn, the less I know.
Yeah.
You know? So anyone that acts like they know everything, I wouldn't take advice from them, unless it's intuitively. I think there's a difference between, because I've had multiple coaches yell at me and call me uncoachable or unteachable because I wouldn't hire them. This happens all the time. People want to, I don't know if they want to work with me so they can say they coached me into my success or something. I get people that kind of cling. But I had someone yell at me yesterday because I was telling him that everything he studied, those are things I'm fascinated with and I study as well. But yet he was trying to tell me that he had more information for me. And I was like, and he goes, let me ask you this. Are you coachable? And I said, absolutely. I just hired a coach for $5,000.
Yeah.
To teach me how to sell on Amazon. I go to healers all the time. I'm constantly telling you, help me, you know.
Yeah.
I love people to help me. I go to hypnotherapy all the time. But we all need to be so strong in trusting ourselves against what anyone else says, because no one has our answers. I go to people to confirm what I'm feeling so I can sort through it. And so I got really upset that this guy was forcefully telling me that he needed me to coach me. And right before I opened this wellness center, I asked what the pay rate for massage therapists is, and a coach commented, she said, I can tell that you're in no way prepared for what you're doing, and you need me to coach you. And I was shocked, and it made me mad even to this day, because I would never push my services on anyone. I'm here to say, I don't even tell you to rebook. I'm like, you'll know when you need to come back in. So,
yeah.
I think it's important that you do know exactly what's right for you.
Yeah.
Above what anyone else's opinion is, even if they're intimidating you or manipulating you to feel bad. But when I say that the more I learn, the less I know, that's just with universal knowledge.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
More stuff about myself.
I feel like that's such a red flag if coaches are like that. I feel like this is an important topic because the coaching industry is booming online.
Yeah.
And people don't know what to do, and they don't know what's right and what's wrong. And we do a lot of coaching here,
mm-hmm.
where we graciously ask permission to
mm-hmm.
talk people through things.
Yeah.
And if somebody judges you, makes a judgment about, like, that person made a judgment about you,
mm-hmm.
you're uncoachable.
Yeah.
Am I, though?
Yeah.
Or are you just not compassionate?
Yeah.
Or can you just not see what I, like, I'm not asking you to come in and control my whole life.
And he just came out of nowhere on my Facebook. I wasn't even asking him to coach me. And
yeah.
So that's why I was like, why are we having this conversation? But I get it a lot, and so it's probably something in me that I need to work through. But I had a friend that...
I feel like it's rude to say that, though.
It is.
Even if you are a coach, like, your job is to be empathetic and to be supportive.
To
yes.
see how you can help them. And I was like, why don't you let people tell you they need you? You don't need to tell them they need you. But I had a friend that I used to go to coffee with, and she told me once I already had this up and running that she was going to come monitor for a day, and that her services are $300. And I was like, I don't need you to come in. It's just bizarre. I don't know why I have this sort of thing happening. Or here's why I think it is. Now it's probably coming up. I have been hearing recently that we don't need to share what we're doing because you're asking people for permission that you don't need. And I think that I just like to talk through things so that I can gather my thoughts. But people want to give advice and they get mad if I don't take it, especially my family, because they always say, you don't listen. I'm listening to everything constantly. But I'm losing my train of thought thinking about my family. Where is that going?
I think sometimes it's important to know when somebody's asking for advice.
Yes.
And when they're,
And when they need somebody to just listen to
just
them.
Just listen.
Like,
yeah.
I feel like we do that with one another.
Yeah.
Like, we don't tell each other what to do, but sometimes you're like, I have all these problems.
Yeah.
And, you know, I could just listen to you, and then, you know, I can say, oh, you could do this or that or whatever, but really, you're going to do, like,
mm-hmm.
you need to just have somebody there to hear you out.
Yeah.
And to talk things out. And I feel like that happens in our treatment rooms, too. It's like, I don't even care what you say if I'm in your energy field and
yeah.
we're working through it. All I need you to do is to just say something.
Be vulnerable.
Like,
get
it out. Like, mm-hmm. it doesn't even matter what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just start expressing yourself. And that's like, it's like you're being... The person getting the healing, like you're on Sarah's table, you're being intuitive too.
Yeah.
You're sensing what it is that is blocked
mm-hmm.
too. And you're saying, yes, that resonates what you're saying, or no, not really. And then you start searching for more and different things. But like, it's not really there for you to tell somebody what to do per
mm-hmm.
se, but to have somebody there to give you that space.
Yeah.
Because talking it out sometimes helps you to see everything.
Yeah. And there's
like your thoughts are a big messy room and you
mm-hmm.
need to lay it all out.
Yep. Yeah, I'm sure your brain is firing and sorting through it like a room. But there's a frequency, and that's where when I work with people, I'm like, if you don't want to talk about what comes up, lie because I won't know.
Mm-hmm.
Or just say you're not ready to talk about it. But there's a frequency when I know what I'm reading is right. And so I'm always asking, does that resonate? You know, I have to have feedback because I'm not the one saying I know anything. I'm a vessel that's channeling. And I will say on things that I do feel are right, I'm like, okay, I feel like this is the path. Let's go deeper so I can figure out what I'm seeing. And then there are frequencies where I do feel like what I'm reading, the person just is denying. So I'll say, well, this is what I'm feeling. Take it home and chew on it. And then let me know. And typically I get a phone call saying that they weren't being honest, and then we work through it. But that's still not me saying, you need to do this, because really it doesn't matter what people do. I've got so much going on in my own life that I need to dig into my life and work through it, and I can just be here to support everyone else. So, yeah, I think that really needed to be said, that always be open to learning from the universe, from God, from within,
yeah.
but not assuming someone else has your answers because they tell you they do. You've got to be able to discern that for
yeah.
yourself. And I think most of us don't give ourselves enough credit to trust that we have the answers.
Yeah, I think that that's so right. And a lot of us have trouble with our parents. And so
mm-hmm.
people online are like filling this gap. Like, I didn't
mm-hmm.
have guidance. I don't know how to manage money. And
mm-hmm.
so here comes a coach.
Yeah.
I'm here to help you manage money. I'm here to help you tidy up your home.
Right.
I'm here
yeah.
to help you have more confidence or
mm-hmm.
whatever. And it's like you put yourself in this position where you are kind of profiting off of somebody else's gap. And all of us are like, we all have it. We all have some kind of gap that we didn't fill in our childhood. But it's like this responsibility is so big. And
mm-hmm.
you do have to know about those red flags because
yeah.
a lot of people are showing up online as coaches.
Yeah.
And if somebody tells you, criticizes you for not being coachable, or they're kind of like not allowing you to
choose if I wanted them to coach me or not.
Yeah. I feel like those are really big flags. And then I kind of want to backtrack and say something that you were saying that about working with your relationship with your father and how your relationship today is not perfect, but you don't get triggered anymore when he calls.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that was so good for me to hear, because I feel like there is this like pressure to like restore the relationship that you had. Like if you had a bad relationship with your parents and then trying to heal from it, like if that looks like going on coffee dates with your parent now. And I'm like, I don't want to do that.
Yeah, it's awkward.
Like, I don't want to have a relationship with them. I just want to be healed from how you hurt me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to have unforgiveness, but I don't want you in my life, really.
Yeah, and that's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, because it really is just about healing your soul.
Yeah.
So maybe you can share how you pieced that together.
Well, I think that the thought that came to mind when she was saying that is that there are some people that are in your life that are just toxic and they're not good for you.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, not having them, having a relationship with them helps you in your walk to just know that, you know, you can be civil with them and be friendly with them, but you don't have to have per se a relationship with them. And so I have those relationships, and it's
mm-hmm.
been nice to understand that
mm-hmm.
I don't have to have this certain relationship with them.
Mm-hmm.
I can just be who I am and let them be who they are,
mm-hmm.
and just know that, you know, they're not good for me, and maybe I'm not good for them either, and maybe that's why there's the clash that we have. Or
I don't know that it's not, that you're not good for them, because people that are healed, I think, are good for everyone. I think that the ones that are healed don't resonate with the ones that aren't. And so it's with our electromagnetic biofields, it repels. We attract people and then we repel as we grow apart. And I know with my daughter's father, he's away, and I always tell her, God's protecting you because you are so special and you have such a special gift for what you're meant to be. I tell her, you got the best years that he was able to give, and he's wounded. He's gone through traumas that he needs to work through, and until he gets to that vibration that we're at, it just cannot happen, which is a protection. Everyone is divinely and supernaturally protected by their own vibrations. So everything that you put into yourself is protecting you, because it will repel the danger. But if you have things within you you haven't worked through, it might actually even attract it, so that you can be met with your darkest secrets or fears, so that you can conquer them. Because if it's in you, it will be around you. I don't know if that makes sense. Is that confusing a little bit?
No, I love that idea that, you know, we are protected and that things happen for a reason. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, we might not have this relationship, but it's good. And I've always felt that way. I've always felt grateful that, like, for myself, is that my father wasn't there, because as I got to know him, I'm like, oh my God, like, I could have totally, like, turned out like you.
Yeah.
I'm such an absorbing person.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I absorb people's energies. I'm kind of, like, open. Like, I'm so open-minded, and I love to, like, eat up new thoughts and new ways of thinking about things. And if I were to have been raised by him as a child and as a teenager, I remember spending time with my dad as a teenager and, like, starting to kind of hang out with him. And he was like, I wasn't really behaving very well, but he was, like, very approving of my
mm-hmm.
lifestyle. I was, like, partying a lot and, like, using different drugs and alcohol. And he was very approving
mm-hmm.
of that, and he would mm-hmm. do those kinds of things too,
because it didn't make him feel guilty having you do it.
And then when he started to flake out on me,
mm-hmm.
and I'd be like, whatever, like, I don't even know if I had an emotional response because I was so callous by then, I later on was so grateful that I didn't pursue that relationship.
And I wanted to add to that, because my dad is really good at, like, taking care of us financially. He's a hard worker, but he's had a hard time connecting with girls, with me and my sister. So it does create kind of a daddy wound in a way. But I really feel like when we have children that are abandoned or adopted out, I believe that they are the ones chosen to save their bloodline. Because, like you said, if you grow up with that, the pattern will continue. I believe that there's a few things going on where you were chosen by the mix of the DNA that you got to be set apart so that you can work on things and heal and do better for the generations, because that the DNA, like, those are souls that are being brought here for reasons. And so it's like everything's designed to preserve and to survive the longest. And so rather than looking at it as I'm unworthy or unwanted, it's no, I am so worthy and so wanted that I had to be protected and set apart. Because I know that's true for my daughter, and I can read it on people when I'm working with them. And so that's how I've come to that theory. So I do think it's a good thing. And I also question if the parent that abandons the child, I wonder if that is their form of loving them the best they can. Because I think we all know the evils within us. And I think we all know, I've had a lot of customers say that they're afraid to have children because they don't trust themselves. And so I think when a parent abandons their children, they are loving them because they know they would damage them. So if we can see it differently, I think it gives children a lot of trauma that maybe they could, you know, not feel if they see it that way.
That's really interesting and a really good way to put it, mm-hmm. because I know, you know, my dad, my, you know, adoptive dad, I mean, he did end up adopting me. I got so much good stuff from
yeah.
him.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that is, you know, was, you know, where I was supposed to, well, it was where I was
mm-hmm.
supposed to be, but, you know, looking at it and hearing it from that perspective is definitely, opens my eyes to,
yeah.
to some of the stuff that I have dealt with that
mm-hmm.
I didn't think about it in that aspect, that
mm-hmm.
I was being protected
yeah.
and I was loved and I did have a great dad
mm-hmm.
and, you know, and I wasn't without that
yeah.
figure in my life.
Yeah. Yeah. If we see the world as each soul has a destiny that they were given before they got here, that's how you can surrender and trust, because there's a plan and there is a certain amount of protection around those individual souls that choose to fight the fight and live out that goal. Because it's based on our choices. We can choose not to do the hard work and step into our calling, and then we crumble and all this bad stuff happens because we're cursing ourselves. And so the ones that do choose to rise up, they'll be given the protection and the resources needed. So I just really feel like if we take all of our children and focus on the positives, then they can see it way different and feel actually lucky.
Yeah, and I think that these, you know, this energy work and the stuff that we do here is so important, because I would have never told myself, this happened for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that would have never come from me. I'm for myself, the way that I view myself, I'm always like, oh, I must have not been, you
good
know,
enough.
A beautiful, wonderful, special baby that my parents wanted to just be there for me. You know, because you think about how you are with your kids. Like, you just show up for them and you're like, I can't imagine not being there for you.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, hearing somebody else say, like, no, you are worthy. You shouldn't have been abandoned, you know, like, and like, your dad is not rejecting you. You're just so special
yes.
that
mm-hmm.
I don't even know what to say to you because
mm-hmm.
I messed up, you know,
mm-hmm.
and I feel like that is, we need each other.
Mm-hmm.
We need each other to say those things, because the voice inside of ourselves and the child inside of ourselves sometimes is so loud, and it like has the steering wheel
mm-hmm.
and you never give yourself permission to say, like, no, that's not true. Like, how can that be true?
Mm-hmm.
You know, if because I don't see that, I would never tell a child that.
Yeah.
Like, if a parent was abandoning them, I would never say, well, it's probably because you suck.
Yeah. Yeah. Some parents do, unfortunately.
But, yeah, it's
yeah.
true. But I, like, if I feel that way for an other, like, why can't I feel that way for myself? Like,
mm-hmm.
okay, the same applies to you, Rochelle.
Yeah.
Like, you shouldn't be abandoned. Like, if you make a mistake, you don't deserve to be thrown out with the trash. Like,
mm-hmm.
that's like, on my dark days, that's what happens to me. Like, if I feel like I'm making a mistake or whatever, I feel like, oh no, I'm going to be like thrown out with the trash. Like, I'm going to be like disqualified or whatever. And I know that that comes from like abandonment.
Yeah.
But yeah, being able to tell each other, like, if you were abandoned by your parents, or if your parent was just not there for you the way that they should have been, it could have been for a divine reason.
Mm-hmm.
You were set apart to experience something and to learn these tough lessons, and it's very tough, but God saw that you were strong enough
mm-hmm.
And what you're learning is going to create a ripple effect in your bloodline,
yeah.
in your community,
yeah. mm-hmm.
and in your audience.
Oh, let me.
Hi.
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 In the wrong
How
place.
Are you?
Let me check and see real
okay.
quick. I've got you at 12:45, right?
So sorry, it was at 12:15.
Let me check.
Did I interrupt? I'm so sorry.
We're doing a podcast real
no.
quick. Hold on.
Let me see.
Yeah, it's at 12:45.
Oh,
do you want to have a seat right out there? And then
at 12:15, but that's fine.
Okay.
I don't mind at all.
Okay. All right. Let me get the paperwork. It's actually at the hour mark. So.
Oh, great.
Yeah. Let me see what she's doing. She's doing a hot stove. Do y'all want to keep
We had a client walk in because
yeah.
we're a booming business. Everyone wants to come in for our services.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know what I was saying.
So you were
I blacked out.
Okay, she's doing a hot stone. Let me get her this. Keep talking real quick and then we'll close it out when I sit back down. Do you want to
well,
look
I would
in-
just really encourage anyone that hasn't been in that's wondering about what you do here.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, that they should consider coming in for a visit or an appointment of some sort. Because I've gone to many different spas and had many different massages, and I just have really resonated with this place. And I just think that if you're curious, make that appointment.
Yeah. I agree. It's I've never been to a place like this before. I think that they are coming up. We were at an energy conference recently and I
yeah.
learned that so many people are doing this work, but I'm not knowing about them.
Yeah.
Like I don't
yeah.
see them.
Yeah, you don't really see them.
But
yeah,
we're here, Aspen Rose.
Spa and Wellness.
Spa and Wellness, Sarah Harvey.
Okay. So Tatum's here.
Cool.
Oh,
it's her client?
Yeah. I was booking a lot of appointments yesterday while I was running errands, and so I think I messed up. So I don't know. We'll have to figure that part out. We had people coming and going. I want to see if there's any questions, because I don't think TikTok shut down on us this time, and last time it did. Let's
yeah,
see.
We couldn't see any questions.
Okay. Yeah, it must still be shutting down. Okay.
Yeah, no questions, just trolls.
Just trolls.
Yeah.
Are there trolls?
Yeah. There's always trolls because...
Hi, trolls.
Yeah. I just see those as like demons. That's how I see it. Because
the
they're
demons.
Trying... Yeah, just the little critters, like monster demons. Like, no one wants to be seen like
That's
that.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
I think that if you have trolls, then...
Well, they say it's
like
helping the to be seen, because if people comment the algorithm,
oh, it's engagement.
Yeah,
thank
yeah.
you.
So it actually is good. So way to turn the negative into a positive.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
I've even heard of like creators purposefully misspelling stuff.
Oh.
So that people will come in the comments and say, well, you misspelled that.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, that's
and
genius.
You're like, if your engagement's low, like,
yeah.
it's like a little hack
mm-hmm.
for you influencers out there.
Awesome. All right. Well, thank you guys so much for watching. And thank you to our guest, Shamara, and then Rochelle, the esthetician. And so tomorrow we're going to have Tatum, our other esthetician, on. But I am doing these live, but I'm going to post them once a week. So I think Tatum will be posted this week, and then yours will go up next week while I'm out of town.
Okay.
So thank you, guys. If you have any questions, post them in the comments once these are posted on YouTube, and we'll get back with you on any questions. And we're at Aspen Rose Spa and Wellness Center in Ogden, Utah, across from Weber State University. We focus on healing the mind, body, and soul through holistic treatments. We also do all of the... We do the inner care and the outer care. So come see us, and we hope you have a good day. Okay. How do I turn it off? And now.